Today, let us continue with the other experiments of Machine Elements Lab. Okay. So, those are, you see, in Machine Elements Lab, if you click here, these are the experiments which we have discussed already, moment of inertia and dynamic balancing experiment. Then we have also discussed about basics of vibration, measurement, FFT analysis, etc. So today we'll next discuss with critical speed first. So if you click here, it will open that particular slide, and for accessibility you need to give me a mail. Okay. So here this slides are downloaded, so let me present from this downloaded file. Okay. So this is the third experiment. This is the experimental determination of first critical speed. Okay. Now the theory behind this experiment, again this theory is covered under Dynamics of Machines course. So there the theoretical critical speed is obtained by using two equations. One is Dancarlet's equation, the other one is Rayleigh's approximation. Actually these two methods, one is an upper bound method, another one is a lower bound method. So what you have to do in this experiment corresponding to the actual specimen on which we will carry out the experiment, you need to calculate these two theoretical values and the experimental critical speed that we will obtain. It should lie in between these two limits. That is what we can expect. Okay. Now let us go into the theory. What it is written here, to find the first critical speed. Okay. So that means, you see in this diagram we have seen previously in our vibration basics discussion. So here if we go on increasing this frequency ratio along the x-axis, then at certain higher excitation frequency, there would be another peak like this. Okay. Those are known as higher critical speed. So this experiment is focused on first critical speed. Okay, and to plot the resonance curve means to plot this particular curve, okay, the magnification curve. So this is what is the objective. This part we have discussed earlier, what is critical speed. And then what is there? Now what this is written here is basically the phenomena of phase shifting. So that part also we will be discussing. You recall that associated with this plot, we had a phase plot also. Okay. So what happens when this frequency ratio, it crosses this particular value, okay, there is a jump in the phase angle diagram. Okay, recall that. And if there is some amount of damping present in the system, you will get such curves. These are critically damped systems. So, and then what happens after this? Okay, the dynamic force coming from that unbalance, actually unbalance in the rotor, it creates the excitation, external forcing, whose frequency is equal to the rotational speed. So that particular vector for this external forcing and the resisting force, the inertia force, they are at opposite direction. So there is a phase shift. This is in phase up to this point, up to frequency ratio 1, and then there is a change in phase. That is what happens in the corresponding phase angle frequency ratio diagram. You recall that diagram. So then this vibration amplitude, okay, this is an amplitude ratio of magnification, this reduces. So you see it starts from 1, but after crossing this particular critical speed, this magnification factor, it goes on reducing. But this is not asymptotic, because at still higher frequency ratio it will again grow. It will go to the second critical speed. This is the thing. So this is what is written here. We will see this effect, okay, after in our discussion. So now this is the thing, and what are the theoretical approximations? These two equations, from where you can find out the theoretical critical speed. The first one is the critical speed of the shaft only, without any external point loading on it. You see, this is our shaft supported on bearings, and these are some disc, okay, mounted on it. So if we consider, this is the shaft only, without any mounting on it, then also the shaft has a critical speed, okay, and that speed is calculated from the static deflection. This delta is static deflection of the shaft itself, okay. So this is our natural frequency of the shaft itself, okay. And then what we do, we consider loading due to this individual disc. They have a weight, as if on this shaft there is a weight acting on it, and while calculating that, we do not consider the effect of uniformly distributed load in the shaft. Okay. So this is the idea of this weightless and supporting only this thing. Okay, this is not a proper wording, okay. This is somewhat confusing. What it means is critical speed of shaft if only weight of disc 1 is considered. Okay. Actually, this weightless signifies that we are not considering the uniform distribution of load coming from the weight of the shaft itself. Okay, and you know how to calculate these critical speed. You have to follow this particular equation once again. That means, what is that equation? Omega is root over k g by this w, or k by delta, right? Because w by g, oh, rather actually
k by m,
it is k by m. Omega square is root over k by m. So that way you can calculate what is the critical speed of the rotor, okay, from the individual critical speed of the shaft and the shaft system with individual disc 1, 2, 3, etc. This is Dankarle's method of computing critical speed. Another method is Rayleigh's approximate method. Right? So here, this is the equation where y1, y2, etc. are static deflection at the points supporting the weight w1, w2, w3. Okay, that you have already calculated here. Okay. So this delta 1, delta 2, delta 3, that you know. So those are referred here as y1, y2, y3. Okay. Fine. So these are the theoretical calculations, and what we'll do, we'll calculate or observe, experimentally find out the critical speed, and we'll make comparison with these results. So, I do not remember right now. You go back to your textbook, you will find that out of these two methods, one overestimates. What does it mean? Overestimate means if we carry out the experiment, we will find out a value which is experimental value. Overestimate means higher than that particular value. And underestimate means lower than the actual value. So that is what means the overestimate. Right? So that this part is clear. Yes. Let us go to our experimentation. This is experimental setup. Okay, the photograph. So here, what we can see is we have a notated photograph also. I will explain it, but first, this is a clear one. Let me tell you what are these things. This is the shaft. You can clearly identify this is the shaft, right?
Yes, sir.
On one end, we have a coupling, and then we have a motor.
Okay.
So this motor is a variable speed motor.
Okay.
But you see, this looks like an ordinary motor, is it not? Like this, it's an ordinary motor. So, this is made a variable speed motor through a frequency converter unit. Here we have a frequency converter unit. You see there is some wiring from this motor to this unit. Okay. Now, in general, for this synchronous motors, what is synchronous speed? 120 F by P. F is the frequency, the line frequency. In India it is 50 hertz, right? And P is number of pole. So if it is a 4-pole motor, then what is the synchronous speed? 120 F is 6000 by 4, 1500. That is synchronous speed, and these are what it is called. There is synchronous motor and asynchronous motor. These are asynchronous motor.
Okay.
So that is why you won't get exactly 1500 RPM. You might get 1470, 1480, etc. Some amount of slip will be there. But whatever be the thing, I do not exactly tell you right now. We have to see that this is the nameplate of the motor, where you will get the exact specification of the motor. Number of poles is a specification. So accordingly, you know what is the normal operating speed of the motor. Now, what is being done here? This is a frequency controller, so we are changing F. So if F is now 10, so it would be 120 into 10 by 4, 1200 by 4, right? It would be 300 RPM now. Okay, so that is what we will be doing during experimentation. We will gradually change the operating the frequency from this frequency controller input. Clear? And then this motor will run accordingly, and we will get the corresponding speed here. So the shaft will run at different speed. What is why we are doing this? Because here we are changing this ratio, is it not? The rotor assembly has a natural frequency. Actually, this frequency is in bending vibration. Okay. What are the other modes of vibration? We'll come to that afterwards. But initially, what we are considering is this rotor is a simply supported beam. right? So these are the weights which will bend the shaft, and it will take a bend configuration, and in rotation there will be wheeling of that bend shaft. Okay. This is the model. So it is a bending natural frequency. Actually, there are other modes also. There are torsional modes also. We are not going into that details, because such rotors, which are usually long, undergoes bending mode of vibration. Actually, short and stub rotors, they undergo torsional mode of vibration. Okay, so that part is clear. This is how we run the shaft. The shaft contains some number of discs. So you can change their position. Some arrangement is there. Other things are also there. Again, what else we need to measure? This is some amplitude.
Yes.
Okay. So to measure this amplitude, we use a sensor. Okay. And actually, the sensor, you see, for fixing that particular sensor, here you see, you can identify there is an arm. Okay. This is fixed with a stand. You can identify the stand there. Okay. And this particular cantilever arm, it contains a sensor here. Okay. So this sensor is an electromagnetic solenoid type of sensor. This type of sensor we are using. Okay. Where we have two coils, out of which one is the input signal to magnetize, to make a magnetic field there. And as the shaft material, this is steel, okay, it will get magnetized. And due to the deflection, what will happen? The air gap, right, in between this sensor tip, which is fixed, say this is sensor tip, which is fixed, and the surface of the shaft, that will change. That you understand, because it is bent, and now this is wheeling. This is not concentric on this axis of rotation. So, and due to that change, we will get a signal which again is picked up by the corresponding circuitry. This is the instrument part. This is known as vibration meter. Okay. So it will pick up that particular signal, and it indicates, this is the analog device, okay, it indicates what is the magnitude of this deflection. This is clear. Actually, it is measuring the air gap. Due to that air gap, the magnetization induction is changing, and there is a change in this voltage value which is measured. Okay, somehow, in not in absolute unit, but in terms of voltage unit, we are getting the result. But ultimately, we are using a ratio, is it? We are not plotting absolute value of amplitude in our magnification. Something. Okay, this is clear. Now, what else? Then we need to calculate the rotational speed also. We need an RPM sensor. So, for that, it is not a photo sensor type RPM sensing unit. We are using the same type of sensor here. So we have already used a electromagnetic sensor. The same sensor is put here, and instead of air gap, there is a 30 teeth gear mounted. So for a single rotation, the gear tooth, when it passes in front of this sensor tip, the magnetization is much higher, and then there is the root part between two teeth, so magnetization effect is reduced. So you are getting a signal and multiply this signal by 2, you will get the RPM reading directly. This gear. So why 30 teeth? Because 60 teeth gear will make it a much larger. Okay, this part is here. This is how, and this is ultimately connected to the RPM meter. Okay, that part is not shown here, but during experimentation we keep a RPM meter here. We have discussed about sensors in our earlier lecture. So that type of sensor. Okay, this is the instrumentation. Understand this part, and you see now these are notated. These are bearings. What are the type of bearings? They are ordinary roller bearings. Okay, and you know in roller bearing there is no resistance to bending moment. So you can take at that bearing location, there is no moment. Moment is zero, but deflection is restricted. Deflection is zero. But there is no resisting moment. So this implies the end condition as simply supported. So in theoretical modeling, when you have to calculate these deflections, okay, actually this equation considers, okay, that the end of the shafts are simply supported. So these are ordinary plumber block in which the housing is a plumber block in which rolling contact bearing is there. Okay, if these things we have discussed, the 30 spar gear mechanism, the bearing, two such bearings, three disc, 1, 2 and 3. Here we have a vibration sensor connected to this vibration meter, then this is the coupling, this is the motor, and then also we have a frequency controller connected with this. You see the schematic diagram. So schematic diagram is like this. The non-contact type sensor for vibration amplitude measurement. Okay. Connected with vibration meter, 30 teeth gear at this end, connected with digital tachometer. Here the coupling, 3 is coupling, 2 is your motor, and 1 is the variable speed driver. Clear. Now, during experimentation, this is the warning, do not run it at this particular speed, then, because there is a possibility of breakage of the total unit. Okay. It vibrates vigorously at that particular speed. Yes. Okay. So that is not allowed. So what we do actually, we carry out experiment from a lower speed, gradually we increase it, as and with that vibration also increases. So when vibration reaches an to some extent alarming level, we cross it. Okay. You cross it, and then again you come back from there, you cross it quite fast. So you will go get not here, but you will get somewhere here. Okay, and then again you reduce it, you take some reading, again in this region amplitude will grow, you come back here. Of course, there are some phenomena which you will observe during experimentation that the reading, they are not repetitive. Okay. At same RPM, that means at a particular frequency ratio, if you measure in ascending order, while increasing frequency you will get some amplitude, and when you are coming back you might get some other amplitude. Okay, we are not going into the reason behind those phenomena, but this is what you might observe. Often this happens. Okay. So, this part is clear, how we are carrying out the experiment, and afterwards what I will do, instrumentation, digital tachometer, vibration meter, vibration pickup, measuring scale. Why that is needed? Because you need these dimensions, the disc, the thickness, okay, the thickness is this, the dimensions or diameters all are equal here, but you have to measure. And the material you consider as steel, 7.85 gram per cc or 7850 kg per meter cube. By that, if dimensions are known, you will be able to calculate the weight. Measuring scale outside a rotor setup, FFT analyzer also we can use, optional, not there. So for FFT analyzer, there is an output from this vibration meter. There is input as well as output. You can take output from this, you can feed it to the FFT analyzer and directly you can find out what are the speed. Okay. So you will get frequency value, the operational frequency, as well as some value corresponding to the natural frequency, which will remain constant at different rotational speed. So that part usually we do not use it here. So this is optional. Procedure I have discussed, make out a sketch of rotor, that such a sketch according to your dimension you should make. Connect vibration meter, motion spectrum analyzer means the FFT analyzer, okay. Actually, it is not spectrum analyzer as such. Digital tachometer, mount the vibration pickup. Mount the vibration pickup means this one, you understand. This one. It is there. Okay, switch on motor, measure the RPM, rotor deflection for various speed in ascending and descending order. Yeah. These are the readings. The RPM reading will get from hand tachometer. You can use a hand tachometer also. At the extreme end, the shaft end is open, you can engage a hand tachometer there. That will give you the reading. The digital tachometer, again you understand, this is the digital tachometer coming from this 35th gear, getting a reading. The spectrum analyzer means this FFT analyzer. It will give you frequency value. Okay. And there is no motion analyzer, but we have a fourth reading. Where from the fourth reading is coming? It is coming from variable frequency generator. Okay. See, we have a variable frequency generator where also we have a analog type of control. So that also give you a reading. But what happens, this particular reading and this reading, all these reading, they are not identical as such, because every measurement has its associated error. Hand tachometer has a slip phenomenon. When you are pressing the hand tachometer to the rotor, there is a possibility of slippage. Okay, if this is our frequency controller, there is a slip in the motor. We do not know whether it is constant for all frequency. That phenomena will be there. Spectrum analyzer means this FFT analyzer. Okay. So we have already discussed about the errors coming from that windowing operation. Other controllers are there. Digital to analog conversion. The digital tachometer. So usually we will get some reading which are close enough but not exactly equal. And where from we are getting this deflection value? From this vibration meter. This analog meter will give you the reading, and if you connect FFT analyzer, there also you will get a particular amplitude value. So these are the readings we are taking. Let us see a sample reading. Okay. See, these are hand tachometer reading. These are digital tachometer reading. Quite good enough. Exact. Everywhere it is exact. Okay, that is quite good. FFT analyzer was not used, and this is deflection reading coming from that vibration meter. Okay, why this is zero? Because here we have crossed the critical speed. We have crossed the critical speed, and we are in this region where amplitude of vibration is much lower than the accuracy range of this vibration meter. So it's we are not getting any reading there. Okay, this is clear. Next, we have to calculate this critical speed coming from Rayleigh's equation and Dunn-Curley's equation. This is the table for your results. Okay. Ideally, this you should carry out in two or three settings of these weights. That means this disc, they can be placed at certain range. You can change their position. So if you change their position, obviously this delta value will change, and this omega 1, omega 2, omega 3 value will change. So this is what we do there, and this is the validation. This particular experimental value should lie within these two values. Now this is a plot. This is the plot of these readings up to 1300. Okay. So here it is zero, whatever. This is only a line plot. Actually, you should make a smooth curve, yeah, best fitted curve, and ideally it should go to infinity. From here also it should go to infinity. Only one result is there. So according to this particular value is, no, it is something there, 1300, and you see these two values are 1160 and 1342. This is 1300, but whatever, you have to see by taking some more readings here, whatever it comes. But usually it comes within these two up. So quite obviously Rayleigh's method is upper, and this is lower bound. That part is clear. So this is the experiment. Okay. Now I was talking about this phase shift, right? This phase shift phenomenon and the other modes of vibration. So what happens when we cross the critical speed? So these are the bending modes of a simply supported beam. Understand this. This is the second mode of vibration, third mode of vibration, and this diagram shows the position of the rotor. The position of the rotor is considered here only. But at this three instant, this is rotating in first mode, corresponding to this, it is rotating in second mode, and it is rotating in third. So here, what are these things? Three points are marked here. This O is rotational axis. You add a line through these two centers, and it crosses the rotor at this point. So this is O, zero, whatever you say. Now the center of gravity, okay, this is exaggerated, but say this is the eccentricity. Okay, from the center of the disc. So this is the eccentricity which we basically correct through dynamic balancing. but still there would be some remaining amount of eccentricity, it is exaggerated here. So there is the eccentricity between the center of the disk and the ceiling, epsilon value, right? And this is swirling. So this is the delta value. This is what we are measuring through vibration meter, right? So this is the thing. And one force, okay, through CG, through this point, our external excitation coming from the rotation, that means m omega square into E, that particular value.
Yes,
that is the dynamic force, external dynamic force. It will act through this point CG point. There is another point, another one, which is inertia force, right?
Yes.
So, this resistive inertia force, it also acts through the CG for this particular one. For the system, it is something different. If you consider here, it has also a direction.
Yes.
So, in first mode, they are in same direction. What happens in second mode, actually somewhere here, this is in same direction for this part, this is in the opposite direction. What will happen here, it is at 90 degree here. But for third mode, they are completely opposite. Okay. So this is what happens, this is the phenomena which is associated with this phase shift, and due to this phase shift such phenomena occurs, and that is manifested in our result here. Okay. Afterwards it is not exactly like that, if we could capture the reading we would get such a plot. Okay, this is one thing. Now this is the phase shift phenomena. At higher speed, if we go on increasing the rotational speed, we would get these modes of vibration. The next part is, this critical speed experiment is based on this particular model, right? The bearing are fixed. There is no deflection at the bearing point. So, we assumed simply supported it there, but actual application, what happens, here these bearings, they have finite stiffness, okay. So, if we make this shaft quite heavy and make a heavy disc there, so the weight of the particular rotor, it can make some deflection in the bearing.
Yes.
And when there is dynamic force, if this is heavy, that external dynamic force coming from that eccentricity between the rotational and the central axis, that would be large. So there might be a deflection in the bearing also. In our experimentation, we are considering these are heavy enough. Okay. So, there are some other models also. These are some other models where the rotor is considered rigid and the deflection is in the bearings only. What is this model? The rotor is flexible and the bearings are absolutely rigid. But in actual case, it is a combination of these two, right? So, actual phenomena is something like this. So, now the point is, for all these models, we can calculate what are the critical speeds. Actually, this was first predicted by Jeff Cott. So, this is the history of rotodynamics or turbo machinery model. Because, you know, such application comes in turbo machinery. Any sort of impeller which has to be mounted by subshaft mechanism is important. So, this is not the part of our experiment, but you must know about this thing if you are interested with turbulence. Actually, this is what is collected from that. This is a chapter by Jenta, okay, on Jeffcott rotor. These are the models of rotor first predicted by Jeffcott. Okay, this is about the theoretical part. Okay, so now let us stop this particular lecture.